you're connected to Business Wrap. Find us online at businesswrap.biz, on Twitter using handle AskBizWrap, and on Facebook, just search Business Wrap. And now, Michigan Reimagined with Chris Buck.
Ah, that pesky coronavirus pandemic. It's devastated countless lives. It's ground to a halt virtually all normalcy, including schools, sports, jobs, the economy in general. But unless you're connected to it directly, you may have undervalued the effects it's had on the arts. Here to discuss how the arts are navigating the pandemic is the owner and director of Opportunity Arts, Mr. Mike Marriott. Welcome, Mike.
Hey, thanks, Chris.
So tell me about Opportunity Arts before we get into the industry, as it were, as a whole. What kind of services do you provide, and what is Opportunity Arts?
So basically, Opportunity Arts does promotional and administrative services for individual artists and understaffed arts organizations. And then through our partnership with Pinnacle, we provide access to fiscal sponsorship opportunities. So basically, we handle the business end for the creative. We joke that we're putting the business back in show business.
Hey, there you go. I like that. That makes a lot of sense to me. You say understaffed artist groups. You know, are there any overstaffed artists?
No. I mean, right? No, that's right. It pretty much is like just puts everybody in that, because everyone sees themselves as understaffed, because if you're operating at a high capacity, you need more grant writing. You need more things like that. So it's, there's always a need for extra bodies,
right,
in arts administration. So we try to provide that.
How did you get involved in this?
So I was a tap dancer originally. I went to college on a dance scholarship. I played sports as well in high school, and I enjoyed competing. So when I got into college, there was still the performing aspect, but there wasn't the competing aspect. So I discovered arts administration in college, and it was, did you get the grant? Did you sell out the show? Did your client get booked? There were suddenly measurables again, and I enjoyed doing that. So that's kind of where it fed that competitive need. It fed both passions. So that's kind of why I went into arts administration.
Got it. And you've chosen to set your organization up here in Michigan.
Yep.
Tell me about Michigan's art scene. Are we where do we rank kind of as an arts community?
I think very much emerging right now. I think a lot of homegrown talent that's coming out of Michigan. I mean, Michigan has always had phenomenal arts. I mean, you look at Motown, you look at, Detroit Institute of the Art, things like that. But I think on a national scale, it's starting to get recognized.
Okay. And why do you think that is?
I just think it's kind of with the artists that are here, I think now people are being able to see it, especially now with the COVID-19 and everything going virtual. People are able to see the talent that's here. Also, there's the affordability factor. If you're in Michigan, we do have Chicago close, so you have that big market. You also have the smaller markets as well. And Michigan's, for somebody who moved from New York, who took 20 minutes to get out of their neighborhood, you can get pretty much anywhere in the state quickly, like especially from being, depending on where you are. You know what I mean? If you're in Lansing, you can be in Holland in an hour and a half. So,
right.
Also talks about how much I drive, but and how fast I go, but.
Right. Okay. So does Opportunity Arts cover the state, or are you pretty much a mid-Michigan?
Yeah, we cover the state, and then we still have a couple of clients back in New York as well.
Too, okay. So the pandemic hits.
Right.
People in crowds, don't happen anymore.
Right.
So how did the various arts disciplines react to that? How have they been affected, I guess, is the better question.
Well, and I think it's kind of both. It's reacting to it and how they've been affected by it. The one thing about artists and creatives are they're used to everything changing on the fly anyway. And so suddenly it was, okay, no more live shows. And all the creatives went, all right, just another speed bump that we have to adjust to. What I think changed is a lot of not just performing artists, but also visual artists realized, oh, we have to go virtual. And we have to be able to live stream. We have to be able to look at different, Zoom and be live in these different platforms to get our work out and to get people to see it, yep. Which I actually think is going to be a benefit in the long run. Because the one thing that artists had when you would go to a gallery or when you go to a live show, you had ticket sale numbers and things like that. But now the reach of being able to reach not just the people there at the venue, but the people that are tuning in, I think that's going to pay dividends later for advertising.
Are there any numbers on that? I would imagine if you had an art show that might have 75 people show up, but you might get 75,000 people that can get access. So are there any statistics emerging about, people getting more exposure because they're virtual and that's where everyone has to be?
I think that's it's being developed.
Okay.
Those numbers are being developed. I think what this did is I think there was a natural progression towards that. But I think this the coronavirus sped that whole thing up. Mm-hmm. So now it's more, and you see the creatives now understanding, like, oh, I can reach this many people. Oh, I can collaborate with artists from different parts. Like, now there's this whole new viewpoint of how we use virtual and how they can eventually turn that into generating revenue for themselves.
Right. So is it fair to say that the artist world is kind of divided into two camps? You got the visual artists and you've got the performing artists?
Mm-hmm. I think, well, and it's funny too, because
with a bunch of subsets underneath each, I would imagine.
Right. And I think now, it's Bob Ross.
Mm-hmm.
Bob right. Ross, huh?
Right. Yes. I'm already
he's
there.
A performing artist.
Right.
Like, he's a visual artist, but he's a performing artist. And I think that's where now it's like, oh, I can do a time-lapse painting. You can watch me do my work in, you know, crunch down time, which is kind of what feeds into, like, social media and everything like that. So I think that's kind of the thing, too, is I think visual artists are kind of now by default also performing artists, because they've added an aspect to it. So you'll see them now, even when they're painting, they'll talk about, okay, so this is why I'm doing this, and this is what this, you know, this is how I make this color, and there's this more almost presentation to it,
right?
As opposed to just, I'm going to paint and create this thing and here it is,
here's a happy tree,
right?
And then do they sell at the end? I mean, here it is, and you know,
and I
scroll,
think that also,
go to my website to look at all
right,
the finished products website, and buy one. And
websites, Etsy.
Yeah.
And I think now that it, again, more of going into that virtual of somebody now who lives two or three states away can tune in and be like, I want that in my living room. Contact that artist, and it can be shipped to them.
Right. Sure.
And so now it's another way for artists, especially here in Michigan, to be able to go, okay, now we can send our work all over the country. And so that's kind of how we're adjusting, is to helping artists understand, okay, this is, your reach has now grown. That's kind of the silver lining in the catastrophe that is COVID-19.
Right. Now, what role have you played? I mean, have you been able to kind of help these artists navigate all of that?
Yeah, absolutely. So, there's that aspect of it. Explaining the new platforms and stuff like that, because there's a lot of artists that are like, Zoom, what?
Yeah.
And then you find different platforms like BeLive, the Artist Umbrella, a local show here, is one of our affiliates with Opportunity Arts. They did a show on BeLive, and it was great because it actually had like the ticker at the bottom, so you could have like, here's where you donate to the artist, here's where this is. And as soon as it popped on, I went, oh, this is ESPN. I'm like, this is the next, like, when you see evolution in front of you and you're like, oh. And so that was kind of what was cool about that, is seeing those different platforms. And now, you know, in the pandemic, there's been the explosion of TikTok.
Right.
TikTok is going, like, so now whether you want to or not, you have to know TikTok if you're going to be a creative and an artist, because you have to use that platform to get that out there. And so those are the kind of the things we're helping navigate.
Okay. Now, I've seen a lot of, you know, nationally renowned music artists doing live shows with no audience, whether it's in a studio or outside in a field somewhere or whatever.
Right.
And so I think, you know, the traditional performing arts, in my opinion, seems to be the music, but you also have stage and, you know, the theater and dance, like you mentioned, mm-hmm. and Artist Umbrella, which we can talk about in a sec. Is that happening much here in Michigan?
Oh, yeah. They're definitely doing things where they're having, a lot of it's being shot live from people's homes. Like, it's coming out of, you know, they're at their house performing, and now they're live streamed in, and Zoom allows you to do those things. And I think there's going to be, you know, as we start to come out of it, there's going to be different venues that are going to be able, you're still going to have the performances going on, but not with the live audience. So similar to like, and it's going to be funny to use this as a reference in an arts conversation, but look at WWE right now and AEW, the two wrestling companies that have televised shows. They're doing shows without audience, but they're broadcasting their shows. Like, Monday Night Raw is still on every Monday night.
Right.
And you're tuning in and watching. And I think there's going to be this transition to, okay, this is how we start to enjoy the arts. Because 40 years ago, I'm going to watch wrestling on my television.
Right.
Didn't make, like, what? You know, and now that's, of course, like, that's what you do. Like, yeah, it's on TV, I'm going to tune in. And so I think it's going to look a lot more like those type of things, where you're having the performance live, no audience, live in the building, but it's coming to your home, and now you can enjoy it in the comfort of your living room.
Right. So as just a layperson who's not steeped in this industry, but certainly a fan.
Right.
It would be nice if there was some sort of a portal, like if it could all be under, I mean, I don't even know where to go to find any of this stuff. You know, I mean, where do I hear a local musician or see one of those Bob Ross, modern Bob Ross artists do something? It almost seems like you need to know who they are and what they're doing and when they're doing it, and then be one of the unicorns that knows where to be and when to be there, where I'm just maybe an appreciator. But I don't know what I don't know. I don't know where to be and how to find them.
And I think locally, one of the things, like if you're in, and I think there's a lot of things throughout Michigan. I know locally in like the Lansing area, they have 517 Living.
Okay, yes.
And that calendar, and that was another adjustment. 517 Living went, okay, now we're going to switch and it's virtual. And so they would have virtual events. So when the Artist Umbrella did their two virtual events, those were both on 517 Living. So if you went in there, you knew when it was. Obviously through Facebook events and things like that. And I think we're to a point now where most people have a Facebook,
yep,
or at least are engaged in it. So I think that's where you're going to find a lot of it. And now they're even being creative on, okay, we're going to have a Facebook event, but if you want to attend, you have to email the artist. They, and you pay via Square, whatever it is, they send you the link. And so they're selling tickets in that way as well. And so now there's, I think a lot of stuff's going to be developed almost like a pay-per-view type platform for the performing of visual arts.
Okay. You know, you mentioned you spent time in New York. I got to ask, I mean, Broadway seems to be the hub of, guess what most people consider performing arts. What are they dealing with? And where does, does that ever go back to normal, or what are you hearing?
I mean, well, right now Broadway's down till the end of 2020.
Right.
And then the I think it's January 3rd, 21 is when they're looking to, is the tentative. And that's, of course, that can
pending
be moved.
Yeah.
But the way they're adjusting, I think, when Hamilton streamed on Disney Plus, I think that was a game changer. Like, I think that was the future happening in front of us. And I think people enjoy, like, for the people that work in the industry, like somebody like me, like obviously you enjoy Hamilton and it's amazing, but it's also when I saw that happen, I was like, oh, you can now watch Broadway shows. Like you could literally get to a point where you could do a pay-per-view buy of every Broadway show and literally sit in your house in Lansing or in Detroit or wherever and watch a Broadway show streamed live if that's what they decide to do.
Right.
To me, the revenue, you know, the revenue increases would go up. Because you literally could, you could sell Broadway shows like a UFC fight.
Right.
And I just, it's, which again sounds crazy, but that's the new, like that's the new virtual reality we're in.
Yeah. And you don't deal with sellouts.
Right. Right.
Right? So if you have a 10,000 seats, you know, auditorium, you could sell 300,000 and.
Exactly. And then once people can go back and go into those crowds, now it looks exactly like we were talking about with WWE earlier. You have a live crowd enjoying the show.
Right.
And it's streaming into your home.
Right.
That's.
Does any of that hurt your head or hurt your heart?
No. Oh, I love it.
Okay.
Oh, no, I love it.
Like, it doesn't take any of the live sound or the.
Well, and it's. I mean, the thing about being live at an arts, to me, being live at the arts, it's like going to a baseball game. Like, I enjoy watching baseball on TV, and it's, you know, but there's something about being at the stadium and smelling the grass and hearing the ball, the bat hit the ball. You're still going to have that in the arts, and there's going to be people craving for that. So I think once everything opens back up, get ready.
Because you'll get both.
Right, because then you're going to have everything, you know, and there's going to be, it's going to look different, obviously.
Yeah.
But yeah, you'll have both of those things, and you'll have now revenue from live, from being, from audiences being there live and from the virtual platforms.
Huh. And then you think about, the jobs that can create, because now all of a sudden you have recording at a high level,
yep,
you know, all over the places and production and.
Well, and the collaborations as well.
Right.
You know, you can now collaborate, artists in New York and Michigan can collaborate together on a show. And go live from their different area. And like, so you can have New York artists performing for a Michigan audience, turn around and have a Michigan artist performing for the New York audience. They collaborate together. They're not just bringing themselves, they're bringing their audience with them, you know? So those are kind of the things that I think are really exciting is as we move down and explore this, what's going to be next. And I think it's, to me, it's exciting.
Well, we're speaking with Mike Marriott, the owner and director of Opportunity Arts. With the minute we've got left, hit me over the head again, and our listeners, where do I go? This seems really exciting, and outside of Hamilton on Disney Plus, which I even am aware of because it exploded, you know, on social media. What's the best way for me to stay in tune? I mean, you mentioned 517 Living, for example, because I'm here in the Lansing region. Are there any other conduits that can tell me what's happening where?
I think, like I said, a lot of your local community calendars, you can obviously go to opportunityarts.org. We can, we're going to be updating things and stuff like that as we're letting people know kind of what we're doing. But find the arts in your community, your arts councils, your state, like in New York, there's NISCA, and Michigan, it's Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs. You've got all of your arts councils. That's where you're going to be. That's kind of get in and then kind of expand out from there.
And remind us of your website again.
Opportunityarts.org.
Makes sense. Mike Marriott, thanks for joining me again.
You bet, Chris. Always love it.